Hi everyone, welcome to our park bench chat for the love of birds. My name is Keith Maley with Trust for Public Land, and TPL is about connecting everyone to the joys and the benefits of the outdoors. And we do that because of the proven ways in which the outdoors can improve our lives, from mental and physical health to climate resiliency to community cohesion, connecting us with our neighbors and with nature. And as the video showed, we know that 100 million people, including 28 million children, do not have a quality park within a 10-minute walk from their home. And on top of that, there's an outdoor equity gap. Communities of color have access to parks that are half the size and serve five times more people than predominantly white communities. So we're working to close that outdoor equity gap by putting parks and outdoor spaces everywhere where they're needed, and especially where they're needed the most. And birds are one wonderful and charismatic way in which people can connect to the outdoors, the environment, and the wider world around them. And TPL is proud to have had a hand in preserving some vital bird migration corridors and habitat nationwide, ranging from wide open spaces to neighborhood parks. And that, of course, includes the Rachel Carson National Wildlife Refuge in Maine, the Chattahoochee Riverlands near Atlanta, Hanning Flat and Desert Springs properties in southern in California's southern Sierra Nevada, just to name a few. And we've been able to protect more than 3.7 million acres of land and have created more than 5,000 parks nationwide to close that outdoor equity gap and connect people to the outdoors. And we know that helps wildlife and birds as well. So birding is an activity that can be accessible in so many ways. You just need to go outside and look or listen. But it's also inaccessible in a lot of ways as well. Access to habitat, personal safety outdoors, expenses associated with birding, representation in birding. These can all be barriers to creating a more inclusive birding community that we all want to see. So we want to bring the benefits and joys of birding and the outdoors to everyone. And we have an amazing panel today of people who will help us do just that, for people who are bird curious and want to know how to get started, to helping us build a more inclusive birding community. So first we have Alvaro Jaramillo. He's an internationally known ornithologist and tour leader. He has published numerous books and papers on a great variety of avian subjects, but what he enjoys the most is his enthusiasm for birds and nature through Alvaro's Adventures, a leading birding and nature travel company. So welcome, Alvaro.
Hi, Keith. Hello, everybody. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for joining us. Next up, we have Karina Newsom. Karina is the Associate Conservation Scientist at the National Wildlife Federation, where she specializes in avian conservation and works passionately to connect people to the natural world through birds. And we at TPL have been very fortunate to partner with Karina at on our Chattahoochee Riverlands work in Atlanta. And if you haven't followed Karina on social media, please do. You'll do yourself a favor. She just brings the joy of birds and birding right through in a very inspiring way. So welcome, Karina.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here.
Thanks. And next we have Kimberly Kaufman, the executive director of the Black Swamp Bird Observatory. And Kimberly is an Ohio native whose lifelong love of the outdoors grew into a passion for birding. And she has played a key role in starting the Ohio Young Birders Club, which has served as a model across many states, as well as the biggest week in American birding, the spring event that has rapidly become one of the largest birding festivals in the world. So Kimberly, we're thrilled to have you. Welcome.
Thank you so much. I'm honored to be here.
Thanks. So I'm very excited for this discussion. For the next 30 minutes, we'll hear from our panelists and about their love of birding and how we can get started in birding for those of us who are interested. And then we'll open it up to questions. So if you have any questions for our panelists, please put it in the Q&A function at the bottom of the screen, and we'll try to get to as many of them as possible. Just please let us know who you're directing your question to. So let's get started. Karina, let's start with you. Can you tell us a little bit about your journey into birds and birding, and what makes birds and birding so joyful?
Thanks, Keith, for the question. And again, so happy and honored to be here among such incredible panelists and with TPL. So birds were somewhat of a later passion in my wildlife journey. From the time I was a kid, I loved wildlife. I wanted to be an animal doctor or someone who worked with animals in some capacity. And it wasn't until I actually ended up in college for zoology, and I was forced to take ornithology as one of my field classes. And I was actually very much terrified of taking that class because I had heard from the grapevine that you had to memorize like hundreds of species of North American birds. And I didn't even know that there were hundreds of species to be memorized. I figured they all looked just about the same, sounded very similar. And I was certain that it would drop my GPA after taking that class. On the first day of the course in our lab, the lab portion of our class, our professor, Dr. Jason Corder, was going through some common birds. I was in Northeast Ohio for school, and one of the birds he put on the screen was a blue jay. And when I saw that bird, I could not believe it. I had never seen that bird in my life. I've heard of blue jays before, but had never seen one. And sure enough, as soon as I went outside, they were spilling off the trees. They were everywhere. And I, who love wildlife, had somehow never once noticed a blue jay, even when they were surrounding me. And so that's when I realized, wow, birds are like just treasures that you find no matter where you are, but you might need someone to show you. And so from that point forward, I dedicated my life to the conservation of birds and sharing my love of birds with other people. And I've been so grateful to be able to not only do research when it comes to birds, studying sparrows specifically, sparrows are my favorite group. I've had the opportunity to really kind of address in my work some of the disparities around who's engaged in community and citizen science and some of the tools that we have available to help people connect to birds. I live in Atlanta, and I remember just based on the research from one of my friends, Deja, who studies kind of where people tend to use citizen and community science when it comes to birds spatially. And it turns out most of the time that data is in rich and white areas, wealthier white areas. So I looked at Atlanta and I found that there was a huge data hole when it comes to who was participating in community science for birds. And so I zeroed in on that location and started building relationships and connecting people with the incredible tools and opportunities to connect with birds and learn more about the birds where they live and get connected to conservation. I could talk forever. I can feel myself just wanting to talk forever. But yes, that is kind of a little bit of background when it comes to my work in ornithology.
That's amazing that from that spark bird right through to this very, very important work. Thanks, Karina. Alvaro, you have just returned from Antarctica. So maybe you could tell us a little bit about that and a little bit about Alvaro's adventures and how you use travel to connect people to birds. Alvaro, you're on mute there, but thank you. I think we still have you on mute for some reason.
You may have to reconnect your audio. Yeah. If you can.
Well, unfortunately, we still can't hear you, Alvaro. So maybe while you work on that and Cheryl and Vanessa can help with that, maybe we'll go to Kim. And we'll come back to you, Alvaro. But Kim, thanks to your work, the Black Swamp Bird Observatory is sort of iconic in a lot of birders' minds. But yet maybe there might be a lot of people who haven't heard of the phenomenon that sort of happens in springtime on the lakeshore there. Could you talk a little bit about the Black Swamp Bird Observatory and why the biggest week in birding is such a phenomenal event? We at TPL, I know, are involved and we're a proud sponsor of it, and it's been amazingly successful. So we'd love to hear a little bit about that phenomenon and what makes it so important.
A little bit about a big phenomenon. That's a tough task. So first, Black Swamp Bird Observatory. This is our 30th anniversary. We are in Northwest Ohio, right on the shores of Lake Erie, close to the city of Toledo. And so many people now know about spring migration through Ohio, but there are still some that don't. And for songbirds that are heading north in spring, they need an area to stop and rest and refuel between their wintering grounds in Central and South America and the breeding grounds in Canada and Alaska. And Northwest Ohio, the marshes in this area are some of the most important stopover habitat for migratory birds in the Western Hemisphere. And so for birds, it's really, really important. And it's a great opportunity to study migration, which we've been doing through a banding study. But for birders, it's an absolutely spectacular opportunity to be immersed in spring migration. And so Black Swamp Bird Observatory in 2010 launched the biggest week in American birding. There wasn't a spring birding festival happening here. It's a 10-day event. It's a long festival in early May. It's timed to coincide with the peak of spring songbird migration. And our opportunity to connect people with birds is so special here. It's just such a magical experience. There's a boardwalk at a place called McGee Marsh Wildlife Area where migration just unfolds all around you. You're not watching it, you are part of it. And we have infused this festival with warmth and friendliness and love for birds and people. And it's a great place to come together and not just enjoy birds, but also to enjoy people coming together for one common love from all over the world in all walks of life. It's so special.
It's amazing. I have heard about it and I cannot wait to get there. I haven't been there, but it's on my wish list for sure. Just the idea that you see those warblers so close up in one area is amazing.
Yeah, it's really special.
Great. Well, I think now I have a question for Karina. I know, just to shift gears a little bit, we know that birds today are facing a whole variety of threats, from habitat loss to climate change. I'm wondering if you could help us put that in a little bit of context and help us understand those threats, the primary threats that birds are facing, and what are steps that we can take as birders or as people interested in birds that can help with some of the challenges that birds are facing today.
Yeah, thanks for that question. It's a really important one. And I'll start by saying I encourage everyone, there is a recent report released that's released every few years called the State of the Birds Report, and the 2022 report came out recently. And so I'll point to that as a resource. It talks in detail about a diversity of threats and problem-solving solutions that are available for helping birds survive in a changing world. But some of the main threats facing birds are a combination of things like habitat loss, which means that the places where they live that encompass their food sources, their nesting grounds, their stopover sites, the places that they rely on to survive are shrinking or being degraded or are being decreased in value. The plants they need, the insects they need, the space they need. Coupled with that, we have climate change, which is a global reality, right? Impacting all hemispheres, all parts of the globe. And this is essentially interacting with, in many ways, some of the threats are already facing, like habitat loss. Climate change is causing more extreme weather events, whether it's extreme hurricanes and more intense hurricanes, more frequent hurricanes, or it's extreme drought, where there's not access to water, or there are massive wildfires that burn through bird habitat, or heat that is much higher than what birds are adapted to withstanding. So there are a lot of threats and a lot of ways to tease it apart. But when it comes to, you know, what can we do that's meaningful that can actually have the impact at scale that birds require to survive in a changing world, I always point back to legislation and being civically engaged where you are. And that's not just, and I'm sure people, especially if you're in Georgia, have been hearing a lot about vote, 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 right? Voting is important, of course, when it comes to, you know, electing leaders who then make decisions about where money goes, how money is budgeted, you know, what they vote yes or no on when it comes to policies that protect birds. But in addition to voting, once those people are elected into office, it's important that we continue to communicate with them what our priorities are. So for example, right now, there's a bill in making its way through Congress called Recovering America's Wildlife Act. And yes, we've voted, we've put our people in office in Congress, in the House and Senate, but now they need to hear from us, right? So they need to hear us say, listen, it is important that we budget, you know, billions of dollars to wildlife conservation to help them survive in a changing world. It's important that we protect our waters, the waters in our marshes and our wetlands, our streams, for people and for wildlife. So we have to kind of continue an ongoing interaction with the people that we elect into office after we vote. And so I encourage people to follow conservation organizations that often do put a lot of energy and time into elevating legislation and other legislative issues that require our attention, that require us to speak up. Because in order for us to make impacts at the scale that we need them, right? Whether it's nationwide or it's statewide or it's countywide, we need to be engaging with the people that we've elected into office or who have been appointed into office. And so I encourage everyone to do that. And I will specifically, not on behalf of Trust for Public Land, but advocate that you look into Recovering America's Wildlife Act, one of the most important wildlife pieces of legislation in a generation. So thank you for that question. Very important.
Keith, I just wanted to add something to Karina's great statement about that, because this is something we work really hard on at Black Swamp Bird Observatory, is helping people understand their own role in bird and habitat conservation and civic engagement, voting, understanding what your state legislators are, you know, what their position is on these things is really important. But sometimes that's a heavy lift for people that are busy with their everyday life. The most important thing you can do, and Karina touched on this, is empower the organizations that are fighting hard for conservation and hold their feet to the fire. Make sure that the organizations that you're already supporting are doing what they should be, that they're addressing cats, roaming cats, one of the leading causes of bird death. It's a controversial issue. It's polarizing. That they're fighting for properly responsible sited wind energy. We need renewable energy. We've got to have it, but wind energy is not right for every place, particularly where there are a lot of birds. So we have to make good choices. And the best thing people can do is hold the feet of the organizations to the fire and support those that do, empower those organizations to keep doing the heavy lifting.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. It's, you know, when we talk about citizen science, it's as much about being a citizen as well and participating in our democracy. So it's such a good point. Thank you. Alvaro, hoping you're able to join us here, but just wanted to check and see if you're back with us. I know we had a couple technical difficulties there.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you and see you.
Yeah. Sorry about that. Some weird thing happened. Never happened before, of course.
But we're glad to have you back. Alvaro, just wanted to go back to a question I mentioned earlier. You had just been to Antarctica, and we're hoping you could talk a little bit about Alvaro's adventures and the importance of sort of traveling and what you do to bring people to birds and their habitat.
Yeah, I mean, I started as a kid in birding. I'm originally from Chile, and I grew up in the Great Lakes in Ontario and Toronto. So for me to say, you know, to think as a kid that I would one day go to Antarctica and actually see penguins and skuas and all these great birds, or let alone, you know, to fly to Bhutan or visit my own country of Chile or even Canada and show people birds, that it's been pretty amazing to do this as part of my work in Alvaro's adventures. But I think one of the key things, and especially given today, we're really worried about global warming and travel and expenditures of, you know, fossil fuels, is that, you know, we're never going to actually get to a solution on some of these things without a couple of things. People are still living life, right? And they're wanting to do things with their life, and they're wanting to enjoy and invest in things that, you know, have sort of a brighter future for the world. And we cannot shut down travel. In fact, travel done in the responsible way, where you get people to communities, to places where they can see birds and actually affect local people that then want to preserve their forest, or in the terms of Antarctica, Antarctica is coming up essentially for renewal in a little bit, when we have to, you know, re-sign all these agreements to maintain Antarctica, a place where we don't, you know, essentially destroy it. Seeing this place and seeing a place where nature, where wildlife just roams, is important. I think that's one of the roles I see myself and tourism, you know, involved in conservation through education and also direct impact to people locally in places that we visit. So that's what I'm up to. But yeah, it was cool to see penguins, let me tell you.
That's amazing. Yeah, I appreciated some of your posts on Facebook, king penguins and emperor penguins and yeah, all these things you dream of seeing. So thank you for bringing it home as well, which is great. Kim, I was wondering too, maybe you could talk a little bit about the role festivals play. Certainly travel plays a role, but the role of sort of community events and festivals that are centered around birding in connecting people maybe who haven't had an opportunity to see other people birding and to experience this thing that we love.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll talk specifically about the biggest week, but I think a lot of this applies to any birding event, whether it's just an outing or a festival or a conference. I think if we go into it with the idea that that event is a connecting point, not just for people who are already in the birding community, who already know about festivals and will register, but how we engage people in the local community who have never tried birding before. And when you think about any event that you're planning with that in mind, a lot of it just comes together. So we really engage the media in Northwest Ohio to get them excited about birds and birding. And that reaches a lot of people, people who have never gone birding. They don't own a binocular. They don't know what clothes to wear. They don't know that they can just come out and go birding. And I think just being as inclusive and as welcoming, as long as they don't hurt birds or each other, every person is welcome in the birding community. And we've taken some approaches at our festival that have been a little out there. We are the first festival to ever have a bird tattoo contest. Just trying to be creative and think of ways to show that the birding community welcomes everyone. And something that was just this kind of crazy idea took on a life of its own. And people who have never gone birding have now been connected with the birding community because they wanted to come and show off their bird ink. So just always trying to look at your event and how welcoming it can be and build that into it, infuse your event with that kind of welcome attitude and that kind of thought. The success will blow your doors off. It's just the most amazing thing to see expert birders like Alvaro, who have traveled all around the world and some of the leading bird experts standing shoulder to shoulder with a person who doesn't even know how to use a binocular during the festival. I just can't say enough how great a connecting point events can be, birding events can be.
That's amazing. And Karina and Alvaro, I want to ask you this too. For a lot of people who are bird curious, they might have just had a little spark of interest at some point, and they don't really know how to get started. What would you suggest to them? What are the first steps that people can take to sort of begin to understand and connect with birds?
I always like to encourage people to start right where they are, whether there is green space nearby or not. You are likely going to see some kind of bird, even if it is a rock pigeon or a house sparrow. And pay attention to what it does, where you tend to see them. Pay close attention to the individuals that show up where you are and just get curious about those individuals, even if they're all the same species. And then I encourage people to do a little research. We're very lucky to have some free phone apps that can help you identify birds. One of my favorites is Merlin by Cornell. You can identify by sound. You can press a microphone and it'll listen and tell you what you're hearing or what's singing around you. It can tell you based on what you might be seeing from the bird. And as you kind of start to learn the birds that show up where you are, what I've seen be true is that people start being curious to kind of go a little bit beyond maybe their front door and maybe to a local green space. And I love to, you know, in those contexts, connect them then to local birding or bird-related organizations that host bird outings or that host opportunities for them to get more information and get more curious. But start where you are, whether it's outside your front door, on a deck, or if you happen to have a tree, yes. Excellent. But starting where you are is the first and most important step, in my opinion.
Yeah, I love that. And I know for me, you know, just signing up for a bird walk locally as a kid just sort of opened some doors and sort of understanding that there were other people that do this as well. Alvaro, I know you believe in something called birding fast and slow. Could you talk a little bit about that and sort of how that might help people think about birding or as they come into becoming a birder?
Yeah, it's an interesting kind of concept to me that our brain actually has two modes of operation. It has sort of this automatic mode and it has this sort of thoughtful and, you know, sort of more kind of look through the data mode. And you can almost think about birding as when you start out, you're in this thoughtful mode of everything, you know, each field mark and what does it look like? What's, you know, where's the red and all that? And eventually you become automatic and you don't even see the details. You just know what something is. So that, you know, Carina's blue jay just becomes the blue jay versus early on, you know, when you're looking at every little bit and where's the blue and the color and is there a crest? Is there no crest? But what's amazing to me is that it's sort of like driving. You know, you start out in driving is really hard and you're paying attention to everything. And that's your sort of like driving slow, and driving fast is when your brain automatically, doesn't mean you're driving fast, but your brain has sort of sorted it all out and then you automatically drive. Birding does the same thing, but you can always kind of step it back, and an expert birder can be sort of brought back to the beginner level by looking at a different or more complicated thing or going to a new place or even showing a new birder a bird and seeing it through their eyes. You sort of can step back and forth between these two different ways of thought in a sense. And it's so deep and rich and like fulfilling in that respect. Unlike many things we do in life, it just sort of expands forever and it's always interesting. And it can be interesting for you to look at your backyard birds for your whole life, or it can be interesting to, you know, discover brand new species and start, you know, dealing with insects and all sorts of other natural history things. That's where sort of the fast and slow comes in, and there's no right place to be. And in fact, you can always step forward and step back in this sort of realm of what birding is. And it's unlike a lot of things. I think it's once people get into it, they don't understand why they're getting so hooked. It's because it's like music. It's like art. It's like everything that is kind of rich and deep that you think like, oh my God, why didn't I do this earlier? And that's sort of the concept of fast and slow in a nutshell.
I love it. I know for me, you know, sometimes I get so fascinated by the biodiversity, like what new birds are in my neighborhood or what in local park, and trying to tick off or list all the different species, that sometimes it's better just to take a step back, not worry about identifying everything, and just watch the behavior and watch what's going on and enjoy birds and look a little deeper at an individual bird and its behavior than necessarily trying to always identify it in the field guide or figure something out about it. So I think that's really helpful, especially when beginning. There's no pressure. It's supposed to be fun. You don't have to identify everything. And just watching birds where you are can open some doors. So that's really helpful. Thank you. I'd like to just turn this shift this conversation to efforts underway to make our birding community more inclusive. And Carina, I want to start with you with the question of who is a birder and how do you define what a birder is? And given that we all love birding and we all love birds, how do we draw more people in who might not see themselves as a birder or might not feel welcome in the birding community?
Yeah, thanks for that question. And my first response is that we should expand our understanding of who a birder is, like those of us who identify as birders actively, you know. And I always say that a birder is someone who appreciates birds, someone who sees birds, notices birds, and appreciates birds. They don't have to know how to correctly identify them. They don't have to know much about their natural history, right? Someone who loves birds is a birder. Now, one of the interesting things that came out recently, I think the Fish and Wildlife Service did a survey and found across the US that people who identify as birders, more than 90% of those people are white, identified as white. And it got me thinking, you know, that's interesting because most places I go, people have stories about birds. People notice their birds. People have their own connection with their local birds. And those are Black and Brown communities that I'm thinking about. But would they call themselves a birder? Probably not, because I think there is a culture associated with the word birder. But one thing that I think that we need to do is to kind of recognize that most people, many people have some sort of connection with birds. And what I do is, as opposed to kind of, you know, approaching the question or the situation where, you know, you have such a large majority of birders identifying as white, is to, you know, in communities where I work and the communities where I live and my family and places like that, you know, I am simply building off. I approach the conversation and the exploration building off of people's already existing connections with birds, no matter how thin that may be or how much, you know, how little or how much experience they may have, and coming from that point, right? And essentially, whether or not someone wants to identify technically as a birder isn't really the outcome I'm looking for. I want them to be able to expand their connection with birds, to expand their appreciation of birds. And I think that as much as we can nurture what already exists in so many people when it comes to experiencing, noticing, and birds being a vehicle to seeing and connecting with the rest of the living world around us, we are doing our jobs.
Absolutely. Thank you. Kim, in your role as executive director of the Black Swamp Bird Observatory, you know, we know that in particular, people of color might feel that the birding community is inaccessible to them. And so I'm wondering what you do in your role to increase inclusivity in birding, and what steps that we can take to sort of support and participate in these efforts.
Well, our team here looks at any potential barrier, and we're making an intentional effort. We're thinking about it, we're talking about it. And the most important thing that we're doing is we're listening. We're listening to voices like Karina and Drew Lanham, and Alvaro and Doug Gray and Audrey Peterman, the leading lights in this effort to help us understand what those barriers are. And we don't get to decide what is racist and what isn't. When the first Black Birders Week rolled out and the organization started talking about it on social media, there was sort of this outcry from people saying, well, why do we need a Black Birders Week? And everyone commenting on that, they were white people. You don't get to decide what's racist and what the barriers are. You just have to listen and then do everything you can to make sure that everything you're doing, whether it's an event, your field crew, that it's an open opportunity for anyone who wants to be part of your organization or part of your event. So we've done a lot of listening. Clear back in 2009, Black Swamp Bird Observatory hosted one of the country's first focus on diversity, just to talk about this, we have to be willing to be in uncomfortable situations, to have conversations that might make us feel uncomfortable, where we're thinking, you know, outside of our comfort zone. We gave a voice to people of color to help us understand clear back then what we needed to do, why it was a problem. The idea that people would still be fearful of going into the woods to look at birds and enjoy nature was devastating to me. And I thought, we have got to do everything, even if it's hard and even if it takes longer to do everything, we have to address this. So we listened. And we implemented some of the things that we learned from that conference, and we've continued to listen and make intentional efforts to have our festival look like the community that's out there. Just like Karina said, those surveys that show that the majority of people that identify themselves as birders are white, that's because we're asking in those places, because that's been the stereotype. We're not surveying people in the right places. There are birders everywhere. And I always think that everyone's a birder, they just might not know it yet. until we can get a hold of them and bring them into our big bird hug in Northwest Ohio.
I love it.
I think we just have to listen, and we have to be intentional, and we have to work hard at it.
Yeah, real. It's really important work. Thank you for all the efforts as well. I think we have time for one more question before we go to some Q&A from the audience. Again, if you have questions for any of our panelists, please put it in the Q&A function below. But I wanted to ask a question for you all. Feel free to jump in, or Alvaro, maybe we'll start with you. How do we help usher in the next generation of people who care about birds and the environment, particularly young people? How do we connect with them to ensure that there's a whole new generation of people coming up behind us that are really connected to the outdoors, connected to the environment, and love birds?
I think one of the things is that the people who have been doing this for a long time and often are the leaders in the local birding community or Audubon societies or bird clubs or whatever they might be, to be really like open and tolerant of difference, and also to not put any barriers up that might be even might not seem like barriers at the time, like what you dress like when you go birding, right? The classic, the muted colors, the broad rimmed hat, you can almost paint the picture of the stereotype birder out there almost in a uniform. And it's not that far from what you see often in the field. And the truth is that, yeah, you can have tattoos, you can go out with pink hair, you can have your Metallica shirt on. The whole thing is about the person and the birds and connecting those two things so that we have more people interested in nature over time. And whatever your preconceived notions of, what we should or shouldn't do as a birder, I think you just sort of have to throw them out. And the important thing is, as a leader in today's birding community, is to bring more people in, just, and open up whatever, those barriers are, and be, like Kim said, be intentional. And it's not always about, sometimes it's just about having somebody feel comfortable, and that's it, and just think about how do you make that person feel comfortable. I remember, as a kid, I had an earring, here, and I remember one of the birders saying to me, "You can't go birding with that, people are going to look at you and whatever." And I'm thinking, like, why shouldn't I? I go out to the clubs wearing my earring, and I feel comfortable. Why can't I be a birder with an earring, this was a while ago, back when those things kind of mattered. And I do remember, I said, well, I'm not going to take this off because it's who I am. And fortunately, I didn't get turned off by that. But I've thought about that. How many times do we turn off somebody by some element of what we think is right or wrong in our birding community? And we should just throw all that out and just sort of let people in, is my thought.
That's great. Kim, I know this work is dear to your heart as well, if you want to comment on it.
Well, again, I just think when you start as an organization, even as an individual, you can have such an impact. Maybe the best thing you can do, when we talked about this earlier, to help birds, is to invite someone to go birding with you. Bring someone new in and help set that hook. Help them fall in love with birds. And I think if we think of it that way, how can we help everyone fall in love with birds? Because that eventually leads to more support for conservation. The more people we help fall in love with birds, that's the really crucial first step. And I think it's important to look at all barriers of racism and bigotry. We hosted the first Gay Birders of North America conference at the Biggest Week a few years ago. We had a gay couple get married at the Biggest Week in American Birding. We're looking at barriers for accessibility, to give a voice to organizations like Birdability. And there's a new company called Access Birding that my friend Freya McGregor has just started to. She's doing consultations for organizations to help them improve the language of not saying going on a bird walk, but saying bird outing. So or not bird watching, because people who have visibility issues love birds too. So little things, we just have to improve on every level. And for us, that includes the barrier of the price of birding. A lot of people have $3,000 binoculars. And if you're just getting started, that can seem like, a barrier. I can't afford to be a birder. So we try to keep the cost of everything that we do low too. So just looking at anything that prevents people from coming out and connecting with the joy of birds, we just try to address all of them.
That's great. Thank you. So let's jump into some of the questions here. The first one from Daryl. What prevents birds' feet from freezing in the cold weather? Karina, maybe you could jump in on this one.
Yeah, I was actually trying to type a response, but it's better if I can show you something with my fingers. So if you've seen bird feet, they're like very scaly, they're very narrow. There's not a whole lot of like soft tissue in bird feet. So they're not susceptible to, like frostbite in the same way that our, toes or fingers or legs or feet might be. They do get cold though. So it may be nearly as cold as like the surrounding temperature. But so for that reason, they don't get damaged from the cold. They also have these really cool blood vessel setups in their legs, so that blood that is leaving the body and going into the feet is warm, and blood that is leaving the feet and going back into the body, which is cold, gets warmed by the warm blood going out of the body. So that way cold blood isn't going back up into the bird and chilling it down. So they have these really cool kind of morphological setups that keep them from freezing, even though they are so tiny and mostly feathers, they are somehow able to survive very cold temperatures.
It's amazing. One of many amazing adaptations that birds have. For all of us, all of the panelists here, there's a question here from Joseph. What is considered quality binoculars for birding in terms of size and magnification? I know, Kim, you address the cost of binoculars as well, but if people are looking to purchase binoculars, what's your recommendation?
My first rule of getting a good binocular is never buy a binocular that's sealed up in plastic. You have to be able, binoculars are so different. Even among the best binoculars in the world, they fit people's hands different. They fit your eyes differently. The balance of it can make a difference. And I would suggest that you go to a place where you can try a variety of binoculars and talk to someone who knows what they're doing. I found really often that beginning birders will come out with a binocular that there was their grandfather's from like World War I, and it weighs like 10 pounds. And they think that they're a bad birder because they don't know how to use the binocular. They don't understand that the binocular is failing them. So in terms of price point, you can get a really good quality binocular. One of my favorite is the Celestron Nature DX, the 8x32 or 8x42. It's around $120, sometimes less. And it's a great family binocular. It's great for kids. It's great for adults. It has a lifetime warranty. It's durable. It's waterproof. And again, that's about $125. Like with any kind of equipment, buy the best binocular you can afford because it's worth it. You get what you pay for. But just try your best to go someplace where you can hold a lot of different binoculars and try them out.
That's great. Thanks so much. This is a question for all panelists. My name is Philomena. I live in Westchester, New York. I have several seed bird feeders and several suet feeders. When all is full, there's a lot of beautiful activity around the house and so many varieties. But my question is, when the feeders are empty, I wait a couple of weeks before refilling with the thought that they will learn to forage and not become too dependent on me. Is that a good plan or not?
I remember there was a study, I think it was done in Guelph, Ontario, on the banded birds at feeders. This probably being redone elsewhere, but you know, when you stop the feeders, the banded birds are actually color banded, so you knew what bird individuals, where they went. They would head off, you would restart the feeder after a while, and they would come back. And they did this kind of research to figure out that the birds actually weren't dependent on the feeders. They were using it because it was the easiest food available, but they actually were dependent on the environment around them. So you can have your feeder on the whole time and you're not causing any dependence to happen. The birds actually are just having, you know, it's a free lunch. So they're getting the free lunch rather than working harder for the food. But the fact is that if you stop your feeding, you're not, you know, putting them in danger in any way. And you know, hopefully others agree, but that's what I recall from this study.
That's a question that we get very frequently at Birds and Blooms. And Albro, you're right, that study, I think it's backed up by years of observation at feeders. Feeders are such a great way to get started in birding. It brings the birds right to you in a place that you're comfortable. If you're in a place where you can have feeders, they make great holiday gifts too. It's a great way to get people hooked on birding by giving them a bird feeder for their birthday or Christmas. But yeah, we always tell people that the feeders are more for you than they are for the birds or for our enjoyment. You're not going to do the birds any harm by not having your feeders filled.
That's great. I know the other thing that I was thinking about too is bird baths and water, particularly running water. I find, you know, if you're fortunate enough to have, you know, space where you can have a bird bath, in some ways they're even more, they're just like a magnet to birds in a lot of ways, even more so than feeders, I find. So wouldn't underestimate bird baths and water too, as well. Just jumping around to some of the questions here. What do your groups do? This is a question from Sandy. What do your groups do to incorporate disabled birders? I had a temporary disability following back surgery and found it impossible to keep up with the leader in the group. Yet I felt like I needed to sign up to stay engaged. And just, she mentions here, just a little bit of tweaking of the trip would have made all the difference. So wondering, maybe Kim, you could address this given your role, but any of the panelists as well.
Yeah, I'm happy to. It's something that we're really working hard on at Black Swamp Bird Observatory during the biggest week and through our Ohio Young Birders Club, is to make sure that our all of our activities, field trips, workshops, are accessible to everyone. So trying to have closed captioning, we're even looking at maybe having some sign language added, and making specific trips that incorporate a lot of listening, so that people who are visually impaired can have a great experience too. I think one of the most important things, just looking at it from the perspective of an event, is to make sure that you're offering training for all of your guides and even the drivers of the vans that are transporting people, so that they understand how to recognize the needs and make sure that we're accommodating everybody so that everyone has a great experience. I wanna mention again, BirdAbility. Their website has a map that will help you understand the accessibility of so many different places, and they're always expanding on that. And then also to mention the new company, Access Birding, which is focused entirely on those kinds of barriers. They're doing extraordinary work, and I urge you to check them out. BirdAbility, maybe we can put the links in the chat. So BirdAbility and Access Birding.
That's great. Thank you, Kim. A question from Luke asks about life lists. And Alvaro, I know you host a podcast of this this name as well. Could you talk a little bit about listing and what is a life list? What is a lifer? And why is it important to some birders?
We named the podcast Life List in a sense because we think it has multiple meanings. So one can be directly, you know, finding new species and adding to your, you know, check marks on your list and adding to your life list, but also the life list, almost like a bucket list, like a thing of, you know, the things you want to see and do in life, is what, you know, sort of our double meaning of it. And I think birding itself is like that. You can, I'm not a rare bird shows up and it's, let's say, new for the state for me. I usually don't go and see it. I don't, you know, I'll see it maybe somewhere else, but I'm very keen on keeping a list of my backyard birds because that's what sort of brings me happiness, you know? And there is a level of, you don't have to have a life list and sort of check off each bird and kind of go to new places to find new birds. It's not necessarily a have to do this kind of thing. It's a type of birding, just in the same way that, you know, in a lot of other pursuits, we have different ways of doing it. But I do think there is an essence of novelty and biodiversity that is in that list component that is really important, that we do like seeing new things. And we do like the excitement of something that's different and also encountering something you might have seen in a book forever and go, oh my gosh, I never thought I could, you know, see a Steller's Jay or something, you know, when you go out west. And I think it's a complicated, interesting thing, but you don't have to have a life list, yet novelty, biodiversity, and seeing new things, everybody likes to do that. So there's sort of an element of how far do you go into that realm of listing? So I leave it kind of open. I'm kind of, yeah.
Yeah, it's a deep rabbit hole, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. couple of other questions hopefully we have time for, and maybe Karina, you can address it. A lot of questions about birds and adaptability and bird feeding here. Is there a concern about groups of birds passing viruses to each other at feeders?
Yeah, so the possibility for disease transfer is always there. And so if you're someone who has a feeder or hosts feeders in your yard, it's important to kind of pay attention to any alerts that come from your local wildlife resources division through your Department of Natural Resources. Usually a government agency will share information if something like avian influenza or pox or some sort of contagious pathogen has been spotted in birds, and they'll provide recommendations for you. Even oftentimes your local Audubon Society will be tapped into those alerts as well. And so if you hear, oh, you know, there have been this disease or this pathogen spotted, please take feeders down, or please bleach your feeders at this interval. Just make sure to follow the protocols. So don't ignore the protocols when they ask you to change your regimen or however you are feeding birds in your backyard. Be sure to follow those instructions very closely. And that is the mechanism by which we can help to prevent bird feeders being a place where disease can be passed in any sort of like catastrophic way when it comes to birds, especially during, you know, migration, when there are even more birds concentrated together and feeding on your feeders.
Absolutely, really, really helpful. And just almost a related question here: how do birds adapt to severe weather, like a hurricane or a storm? You know, where do they go? How do they take shelter, and that type of thing?
You know, if this is a thing I was just reading, which I thought was interesting, is there was a typhoon. Big, you know, massive storm that went through Japan recently, and they had shearwaters. So these are ocean-going, kind of little albatross-type birds that are out in the middle of the ocean, and they had them satellite tracked, and they just happened to coincide with this weather event. And they found out that when they were further out from the storm, they just sort of rode the winds and avoided the storm altogether. But if they got caught in the storm, they did the weirdest thing: they went right to the middle of the storm. They went right into the eye. And what occurred to me, and also they knew where the land was, so they didn't want to get on top of the land where these birds can't take off easily from land. They have to be out in the ocean. So there were all these elements that these birds were reacting to in an amazing way, I thought. So they were trying to get to the safest place, not get on land or avoid the storm, depending on where they were. And you realize they have a lot of tools. And other birds in other situations of bad weather, or, you know, migration of robins in the winter when it gets really cold, midwinter, they can adapt in ways that we sort of marvel at, in how they just sort of come up with solutions. And they're not as sort of weak and defenseless as we think they are. They, in fact, they can read the environment, deal with the environment, and even deal with, you know, 100-mile-an-hour winds if they have to out in the open ocean. So I was just amazed, these shearwaters doing this stuff, trying to get into the eye.
Just amazing adaptations when you start, just starting to observe birds and learn about birds and sort of the miracles that are just outside the window here. One last question I'll ask before we wrap from Richard, and I'll try to paraphrase this, but he says, for any of the panelists, one of the barriers to birding is the pressure on public lands from the recreation community. And a few years ago, you mentioned about sandhill cranes having sort of soft dialogue and hearing those birds, being able to hear those birds, but not being able to hear some young pileated woodpeckers because of sort of vehicle traffic along that road. So could anyone speak to sort of that recreation versus conservation, and how, you know, we want people to connect to the outdoors, but how do you balance the interests that people have when accessing the outdoors?
I'll just say quickly, we work really closely with Metro Parks of Toledo in our area, and they do a really brilliant job of maintaining that balance of all the different interests in the outdoors. And I love birds. I'm looking at birds everywhere I go. But when I'm outside, if I see someone outdoors with their family, even if they're not looking at birds, and they should be looking, if they're just outside enjoying nature with their family. I'm thrilled to see that. It becomes a little bit more challenging when you're talking about areas where they have like ATV trails and those kinds of things. But I think there's a place for that. And this touches on probably the biggest challenge that birds and humans face, is that the world is becoming overpopulated and there's so much demand for spaces. One of the best things we can do is support the expansion of these areas. So make more areas, set aside more areas. And the more demand there is for it, the more our metro parks and county parks will pass levies and expand the opportunities for everyone that wants to go outside and enjoy being outdoors.
Absolutely. And I know we at TPL are strong believers in that. We need more parks. We need more public lands. And the great news is that there's more interest than ever before. And I think our approach often is to do a lot of listening to the community. And it goes back to Karina's point from the beginning of our conversation about the importance of civic engagement and the importance of participating in the community that you want to see, and making sure that the public lands and parks are reflective of the values of the local community, and that you participate in that, and we do as much outreach and inclusion in that process as well. So with any luck, we'll have more and more people joining the birding community and advocating for these places that are not only important to people in getting out and connecting to nature, but also to birds and their habitats as well. So I want to thank each of you. It's been thrilling to be able to hear your perspectives. So thank you, Alvaro, Karina, and Kim, for joining today. And congratulations on the amazing work that you all continue to do to make sure that birds are protected and that birding is welcoming and inclusive for all. So this recording will be on our website in the next few hours, and we'll be sending an email with the link. And we'd ask too that you please consider making a contribution to TPL. We are working to preserve and protect and create more places that bring us outside so everyone can connect with the outdoors. So thank you all for being here, and take care.